top. Few guys made it. On the East Coast, there was Eddie Carlton's tribute to Buddy. Each sold-out performance began with a declaration of musical debt to the real Buddy in heaven. But scores of female fans, too young to remember, declared that Eddie was the one and only. The Deep South was Leonard Hank Taylor's turf. So closely did Leonard capture his country hero's heart and soul, he often confided to friends, "I can only pretend the hurtin' won't claim my life, too." The West Coast was in the grip of Patrick Nelson, who did Sid. Chants of Sid lives, rose at every performance, and usually followed the star back to his hillside retreat, where an aide would pass on this message from Patrick: "Yes, Sid will never die." Between those operators, the big-time tribute racket was pretty well sewed up. New talent had it tough breaking in. But from the north, there was coming a man who would one day smash the order and shape an all-new and almighty tribute empire. His name was Ronnie Boyles. He had a dream.
Chip in $5 for the PA, Randall.
What?
You heard me. $5.
What if I said it was broke?
I'd say the guitar stays behind till you get unbroke. Now, come on, which is it?
Took his first fateful steps on the road to worldwide tribute domination. That's the beginning to one of Stephen Penny's unfinished versions of Crime Wave. He wrote it on the back of the rent papers my father gave him when he moved into this apartment over our garage. The ending was written on the next page. It goes like this.
He will not be forgotten. The place of Ronnie Boyle's final bow has since become a shrine, boasting of thousands of visitors yearly. Some come to wonder, others come to pray. And here's a playful young man trying to fit his face into the great man's farewell impression. Not quite, son, but who knows? Maybe someday he'll grow to become the next tribute king. After all, for Ronnie Boyles, it started with nothing but a dream.
Stephen wrote many other beginnings and endings for Crime Wave. He once told me that beginnings and endings are easy for him to think of, but that he has trouble with the stuff in between. Lots of that trouble comes because Stephen wants to make Crime Wave the best color crime movie there is. And to do that, the script would have to be the best color crime script there is. This is Stephen's favorite kind of magazine. Once, when Stephen thought he couldn't write, and almost died twice, something I found in here led him to the middle of nowhere. And there he got the power to go on. This is Stephen Penny. I remember the first day he came here perfect. That's when we first saw that he's a quiet man.
Is he even there?
What is this, some kind of peep show?
It's him! It's him!
He must have something on his mind. You wouldn't understand.
Jerk.
Just kidding.
Stephen was also a happy man. I could tell, because on that first day I heard him laughing. He must have been a happy man, because most people I know need the TV or a joke to make them laugh. About Stephen. He only liked to work by streetlight.
No.
No, no, no. It's not at all like that, Mr. Boyle. It's cancer.
It was neat to have a real movie person living over our garage, and I was determined to save everything I could from him. The next morning, I saw that Stephen didn't mind at all. Stephen and I were now best friends. He showed me lots of neat things about how color crime movies worked. First, he colored a body onto a notepad, and then put a black dot in the middle of it, and then another black dot on the next page, right under the first black dot. Now, I was supposed to stare at the first black dot for two choruses of When the Saints Come Marching In, played by Stephen on his harmonica. Then, Stephen would flip the page, and I was supposed to stare at the second black dot until I saw the body. For the thing to work, it was very, very important to keep my eyes only on the black dots. Come on, you try it too! Remember, keep your eyes only on the black dots. Keep staring. Stephen called that persistence of vision. Because the eye can see a picture for a short time after it's gone, on a color crime movie strip, you don't see the blank parts between when one picture is projected to when the next picture is projected. Everything is blended together into one moving picture. Do you see how that works?
Yeah, that's very interesting.
And did you know that since it takes a projector more time to move between frames than to project them, we're actually looking at a blank screen for longer than anything?
Well, next time we go to a movie, I'll have to demand a cut rate.
Hope you have room in there for your homework.
Yeah. On the third night that Stephen wrote an all-new beginning and ending for Crime Wave. The beginning went like this.
The top few couples made it. On the East Coast, there was Max and Veronica Lowen, triple diamond winners. After 20-plus record-breaking years with Allway, they were still going strong. We're crazy about all the products ourselves, said Max, so merchandising has always been easy. The Deep South was Bob and Dee Dee Brandt's turf, double diamond doers. Did success go to their heads? Of course, the income potential is exciting, said the Brandts, but the opportunity to develop lifelong camaraderie surpasses any material gain. The West Coast was in the grip of Paul and Bertie Yeoman, new diamond up-and-comers. With soaring interest rates, they decided to get the heck out of real estate and into Allway. And were they glad they did? The new diamond lifestyle is everything they dreamed of and more. Between those operators, the big-time direct distributors racket was pretty well sewed up. New talent had it tough breaking in. But from the north, there was coming a couple who would one day smash the order and shape an all-new and almighty direct distributors empire. Their names were Skip and Don Holliday. They had a dream.
Nice, huh?
It's just like living beside a strawberry plantation. Don insists on it at our place. And it's safe up to 39 Celsius.
My stars.
But what do you have in the way of moisturizers?
Don will be right back from the little girl's room, and she'll be more than happy to demonstrate our fine selection.
What are you doing? Who are you?
Skip! Leonard!
Triple diamond record breakers. Wouldn't I like to be on holiday? Congratulations, Skip.
You know, I just gotta say, it's only in a great country like this that all that's happened to us happened to a couple like us. Mm-hmm. Any place else, we might have ended up herding sheep, or digging coal, or stuffing fortune cookies, or respectable enough jobs. Mm-hmm. But I imagine for us, a bit frustrating. Of course, we've had our ups and downs, but who hasn't? But our low-down downest was certainly better than digging post holes for the bamboo or iron curtain.
Let them! Okay, everybody, hit the deck! It's the holidays we want!
Holidays are dead, but the mark of their achievement would live on, a shining beacon beckoning those couples who, like Skip and Dawn, had a dream.
You should have just enough time to complete problems 4 and 5 in your notebooks. I don't want to hear any talking.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I can see where the extension cords have been biting into your ankles.
Mm-hmm. Get to work. After school, Steven showed me some more of his neat stuff. Hi, Steven. He showed me his camera that was made in Switzerland and wound up like an old kind of watch. It was called a Bolex. Lots of beginner people use them. And also Chekhov from Star Trek and Yoko Ono too. Steven said it was a very good camera. Steven also showed me the film he used. It was called 7291 and it was made by Kodak. Steven liked to watch the tape sparkle blue when it came off the can. You had to be in the dark to see it. Steven said it was a very good film. One of Steven's attacks of self-doubt. Later, his self-doubt would make him want to quit writing Crime Wave. Last, Steven showed me a recording of a speeding car that lost control and smashed a camera that he borrowed from the National Film Board of Canada. $2,000, and later, when his movie was finished, almost nobody liked it.
Oh my.
Well, it can be a risky business. You've got to be careful.
Steven should have maybe had some professional help.
Spend a small fortune and you're going to lose your shirt. And what's to keep him from making another dud?
All that happened before Steven got interested in making color crime movies.
Well, only time will tell.
As the days passed, my carpet got lumpier and lumpier from Steven's story. At night, when the streetlight came on, I heard less and less typing, until one night, when I heard almost none. The next day I said, "Let's go for a walk, Steven. You've been working too hard." We went all over. It was fun. I even got to tell mean old Jane McCluster how stupid she was.
Jane, Jane, make that pain.
Brave girl. Let's just see how brave you really are once I get you alone, you little shit.
I know you are, but what am I?
Steven seemed to be enjoying himself. But every streetlight reminded him of the coming night. And he didn't enjoy that. Maybe there would be no typing that night. When we got back, I could tell that Steven didn't want to go up.
Hey, I have an idea. I could sneak you in later, and when my dad gets back from the club, we can listen to my mom and dad do it. They always do it after that.
Steven thanked me, but no, he had to give it one more try. That night, it would be all or nothing at all.
Third beginning and ending for Crime Wave that night. The beginning went like this.
The top few people made it. On the East Coast, there was Dr. Jane Dover, self-help's happy giant. There was a time when the good doctor feared she'd never become the kind of no-limit person she craved to be. Then, she got on her own side and kapow! The Deep South was Samuel J. Phelps's turf, the Method Man. When Mr. J. needed a surefire, no-nonsense blueprint for success, it was observation and experimentation used by leading scientists that launched him into the Maxisphere. The West Coast was in the grip of Manny Brandon, Gaylene Dazio. Squandered potential for creative living once tormented this now duo, but that was before the chance collision of psycho-cybernetics and total zone contact brought out the they in them. Between those operators, the big-time self-help racket was pretty well sewed up. New talent had it tough breaking in, but from the north, there was coming a man who would one day smash the order and shape an all-new and almighty self-help empire. His name was Stanley Falco. He had a dream. Took his first fateful steps on the road to worldwide self-help domination.
The ending went like this. Stephen had done it. After all his beginnings and endings, he would finally go all the way. He would become a successful color crime movie maker, and I would bring him to class and we would explain how it was done. First thing in making a color crime movie, you need a color crime movie maker. This person here is a color crime movie maker. His name is Stephen. He lives in our garage. When you make a movie, you have to learn how to type the script out. You can sometimes type during the night or during the day. The best thing is typing during the night by the street light. I called Stephen at lunch to congratulate him, but there was no answer. I called again at break, but again, there was no answer. Stephen! Stephen! It wasn't till I peeked in the window that I learned the awful truth. Stephen had failed and went straight from his typewriter to his bed and didn't leave it. His plan was to not eat or drink and let his beard and fingernails and toenails grow and stare at the ceiling until he starved.
Well, that's his privilege, and I suggest you don't bother him so much.
Hold still.
Well, hurry up.
I could see if anyone was going to save Stephen, it was me. Stephen! I have some good food for you. Stephen? I left supper by the door, and the next day I left breakfast and lunch too, but he didn't touch them. So I took a spare key and slid a fresh dinner right inside, hoping the good smell would make him hungry. An hour later, I saw that more than half of it was eaten, and I was happy until I saw that Stephen's suite had rats!
it, Stephen.
I should have had the pros in the first place, but no. I had to let Charlie Harris next door talk me into using his two-step and drop-dead meatballs. I told him that rats aren't like cats or dogs. Here.
Kim! When Stephen's finished, would you bring him up to the guest room? I'm going to get it ready now.
Yes, Mom.
Shouldn't be more than tonight, Stephen. Cheers. Say, I know how I can make it up to you. A party. A costume party. We're going to one of our friends tomorrow night. You could be our guest.
Can I come too?
I don't see why not. I'm sure you can put something together. Think about it. You'll enjoy yourself.
Yeah.
From the outside, Stephen seemed better. But inside, he was fighting the biggest battle of his life. It was then that Stephen decided to give up on color crime movies and consider getting a real job. Much better because he decided to come to the costume party with us. I came as a fairy from the Nutcracker. Mom and Dad came as two native Indians. And Stephen came as Nelson Mingus, who last year tried to rob the Westdale Royal Bank.
Upstairs. Come on.
is this way. Come on, come on. Stephen, Lyle, Stephen. Lyle showed Stephen and me his stuff. Lyle's favorite things are planets and dinosaurs. Lyle said that the average size of a dinosaur's brain was no bigger than a walnut, but at least they used most of it. Through his telescope, we could see the moon and other neat things. Lyle said that by studying the stars, you could show how Jesus was probably born years before most people say, and not on Christmas at all.
Lyle, dear, I want you to do me a favor. Run down to Max and pick me up some Nicks. You can take your dad's car, and your friends can go with you.
On the way to Max, Lyle showed us one of the trailers he worked out of. Lyle worked for the city of Winnipeg in the traffic department. He was a car counter. He showed us how it was done. Cars were counted so people at City Hall could know if traffic lights were on long enough and stuff. Sometimes people were late for work or even died because lights weren't set right. Lyle said the best part of the job was the other guys. They were all good people and some of them were funny. One or two were crazy. They all made over $12 an hour, including Lyle. Stuck to the wall there was banana stickers from all over the world, a picture of the mayor, and a postcard from an ex-car counter who won the lottery and moved to Florida. At Max, Lyle bought the mix, a package of cigarettes, some gum for me, and a lottery ticket. Over the next few weeks, Stephen mainly rode his bike around and looked at things. He saw a place where the streetcars used to go. Two puddles that never seemed to dry. And one morning, Stephen saw a really bad car accident where the rescue men had to use the jaws of life.
That's what we're doing.
Hold on.
Okay, he's clear.
Stephen thought the jaws were really good. But he was afraid that one day, if someone wasn't careful, they might fall into the wrong hands. In the afternoons, Stephen mainly rested downtown. There he saw lots of the same guys every day. They all seemed to know each other, and they were getting to know Stephen. It was a good life, but sometimes guys in half-ton trucks wanted to talk to them.
Why?
Never mind why. Come here. Come on, come here. I want you now.
get him!
Still new and in little danger. At night, Stephen was part of a club. Well, kind of a club. Stephen was the only real person in it. The rest were characters from the different crime waves. They all mainly sat around and thought of what might have been.
Can't you see what I'm doing here? Pour me a drink.
Pour yourself.
Are you gonna play?
Yeah.
I'm losing my mind.
Now, Ronnie, don't you start curling your lip up like that, you hear?
I got to call it a wild time.
Hey, don't mess me up, Ronnie! Back up!
Hey, come on, Don. It was just getting good. Let's go.
Faster.
Hey, you want to put on a show? I got the best seat in the house. Hey, what are you, chicken?
All right. Come on, King. Come on, guys, don't fall! Come on, come on!
next morning. Crime Wave was going no farther, and Stephen was in early retirement. It was then that I spotted what would turn out to be new hope for Stephen. Too long, because there were dangerous signs on our street for Stephen. A better day because it was Stephen's birthday.
Stephen! 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 Read this! Don't ask why, don't ask how, just read this! He thinks he can help you. And he's a doctor! Look at this! All the middles need are twists! That's all! Twists! And look at these! A bus ticket to Sales, Kansas! That's halfway between us and him! And here's a reservation at the Sales Motor Co. Satellite, color TV, and even a pool. And expense money. He's rich, Stephen, and he wants to help you. everywhere. Little did I know that morning that Dr. C. Jolly, sometime after he placed the app, would go crazy for no reason that anyone knew of. He did lots of terrible things to innocent people, and later told everything to the police.
Yes, dear.
Yes.
I should arrive and see you sometime after lunch tomorrow. Okay, put him on. Hello, sport. What's that? Not sweet enough. Well, that's why they call it unsweetened. Like oranges, don't you? Well, it's the same thing. Yes. Yes. All right. Be good. Bye-bye.
Chips and green. I'm back in the saddle again.
Stephen got as close as 10 miles to Sales when things took an unexpected turn.
Trouble, officer?
No traffic through Sales.
But I have a fare getting off there.
Sorry, Sales is off limits.
Problems?
Can't say. We're working on it.
What about my fare?
Sorry, can't help you.
What was happening in Sales was that something escaped into the air from a close-by secret place, and everyone had to leave their homes fast. Secret stuff fell all over everything, and if someone's dog or cat was left behind, it was too bad for their dog or cat.
Hello.
Hi there, Doc. MD plates.
Oh, yes, of course. What seems to be the trouble?
I'm afraid I can't let you pass. Sales is temporarily off limits. I'm not authorized to say why at this time. Do you have business in Sales?
I got business in Sales. I come 100 miles to breathe this here, bitch.
and I want to know what's going on.
Now, hold on a sec. That ain't no way to talk now, is it?
What is it? Town on fire or what?
Look, I don't have to tell you nothing. Now, if you know what's good for you, you'll get back in your truck and keep moving.
I'll be turning back now, officer.
Okay, Doc. Sorry for the
Not at all.
Happy to cooperate.
For Christ's sake, will you listen to that? It's prime time.
Jeepers, mister. You got some kind of a dog back here or something?
What is Polo? Polo, what is it?
What's the matter, puppy?
Come on, Polo. Polo.
Oh, baby, what's Polo? The matter,
Polo? Polo. Shut the
hell up! What the hell? I'll get you, you son of a bitch. I'll get your ass.
Adios, amigo.
Kid, I didn't bring you this far to see you stop now.
Just don't step over the wire.
For God's sakes, it's only a little detour. Come on, let's go.
Come on, yeah, let's
follow
go.
Me, Dom. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
saw even Penny. I thought you'd be bigger, broader shoulders. Hard to tell from a photograph. Am I what you thought? Hey? Hey? Ah! Stephen, I want you to know something. I want you to know that I've never wanted anything so badly as to show you what I mean by twists. Let me show you.
Stephen! That night, I knew that Stephen was in very great danger. What I didn't know was that thanks to a series of strange and fantastic happenings, the darkest would turn to light, and Stephen would become transformed. This is what happened. Police would be taking Dr. Jolly's confession, and they'd find his car and the body in the trunk of his car and everything else he described, except for Stephen. They wouldn't find him because there was no more Stephen. At least not the Stephen we last knew, my friend who couldn't write middles and who saw his every last hope go bad. No, they wouldn't find that Stephen, because thanks to the power of a Kansas streetlight, he was given the strength of the world and a wonderful new beginning!
Presented itself during an all-color crime movie bill when Stephen was still with Mother.
I can do better!
The time for talk had passed. Now it was time for action. Once on the outside, little Stephen's zest for life could hardly be contained. As Stephen grew, so did his imagination. So soon enough, Steven was ready for his first movie camera. Before long, it was showtime. And so, Stephen Penny took his first faithful steps on the road to worldwide color crime movie domination.
The ending went like this.
To be good. With those words, Stephen Penny took his last breath and closed his eyes to the world. I really did mean to be good. A strange epitaph, considering that Stephen Penny, since rocketing onto the scene some dozen years ago, has had nothing but success. First came the trio of blockbuster features.
Cut him loose! Cut him loose! I want that son of a bitch loose! Cut him loose! Cut him loose!
I've got to stop this!
No! Let him go!
Whoa! That's great!
You guys are terrible!
Hey, don't blame me! John wouldn't let me keep it!
That's for last, Don.
What is it, you brat?
Let's see. I mean, just for you, if you like it. Oh, room service. Oh, it's day done. Oh, quiet. It's quiet. Best for last, Don. Fuck you, honey. Fuck you, Becker.
Come on, you bastards! I'm ready for you!
If there was one thing on which those first audiences agreed, Stephen Penny delivered! And kept on delivering with brand new titles, sequels, remakes, and special editions, all playing to jam-packed houses across the world! Translated into over 24 languages.
放开条女，系我用枪打瓜你。
Whatever one uses to measure success, the dollar, pound, peso, Deutschmark, or yen, the sum total of Stephen Penny's career to that point came to one thing. He did good. But what about the man? Did instant fame and fortune change him? To ask that is to not know Stephen Penny. Like before, he was always ready with a helping hand on the set. Always open to story suggestions from members of the crew, no matter what their station. Forever willing to try something new, Stephen Penny looked to merchandising his popular creations. Soon, books, comic books, records, t-shirts, trading cards, and toys appeared bearing the familiar Penny trademark. Before long, Santa became only one of three big names to kids at Christmas. Meanwhile, Stephen Penny's peers, the critical establishment, various institutes of higher learning, and of course, the public, joined to make him the most highly honored individual in color crime movie history. He possessed 9 suspects alone. Inevitably, awards came to mean less and less to Stephen. Often, while star-studded tributes raged elsewhere, Stephen Penny sought diversion at a favorite local night spot, making small talk with the regulars, or blowing his heart. As those close to Stephen could see, he was getting bored. What he needed was a new challenge. How about a lovely young wife, a beautiful old home, and two little angels on earth? Fine, for a while. But how about a theme park? All aboard! And so, the first host of Happy Holidayers heeded the brakeman's call. En route, magic touched everyone. Such was the attraction of Stephen Penny's most enchanting creation. Of that, only the man himself was missed. Did the bitch goddess success claim another victim? From the time of the completion of the park to just before his early death, Stephen Penny lived in a state of limbo. Aimless. Tired. Napping often. The old spark gone. Looking through his wardrobe, he saw his life pass before him like a parade. And at the end, coming closer, within sight now, death. Nights were spent awaiting the inevitable, but fearing the inevitable. Life was empty. Would death bring change? Joy, 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 joy in his heart. Stephen Penny's last act was to visit the man who wronged him most and forgive him everything. That was one twist the doctor never anticipated. Now, frozen for the ages, Stephen Penny rests peacefully while old friends gather to say goodbye. But to an entire generation of new friends, the word is hello. I really did mean to be good. Well, Stephen, if you were alive today, I wonder what you'd say to these kids, the hope of the future, who really do mean to be just like you.
Thank you.
I guess you're wondering, what about the middles? It's like this. Steven never really could work those out, and still can't. But that's okay because I can. I've got one right here and it's all about Steven's struggle. And you just saw most of it. Steven and I are gonna become partners, make it to the top, and cut everything right down the middle. Aren't we, Steven? Steven! All right, what is it, Steven? Steven, come on, what is it?
Steven and Jim are buddies, also partners for life. Maybe when Jim has grown up, they'll even be husband and wife. When streetlights shine in the evening and long and do as they should, Steven and Jim are typing stories to make us feel good. Middles are hard to think of, as every scriptwriter knows. Steven would often panic, though rich it down to his toes. Now he has Jim to help him, there's barely a cloud in the sky. Steven is almost happy, as sane as you or I. Middles are hard to think of, as every scriptwriter knows. Steven would often panic, though